You may perhaps remember last time I gave an outline of the four distinct schools of later Buddhism, the two realists and the two idealists. The two realists are Sautrandigas and Vaibhashikas, both of whom accepts the objects in the external world as real. And also the two idealists, the Vijnanavadins, that is they're called, sometimes they're called subjective idealists, and Shunyavadins, sometimes called as nihilists, the two idealists. Now, there's a special reason why I gave a rather detailed outline of their philosophical positions. Among the two idealists, there are some differences. And among the two realists, also there are differences. Now, Gaudapada's main task in this text is to establish Advaita, the non-dualistic philosophy. Now, as part of his attempt to refute the four schools of Buddhism, he employs a very special technique. He makes use of their internal differences to refute their arguments. So you have to remember, Gaudapada Karika is, the text that we are dealing with, is not just a religious or philosophical work, it is also a dialectical work. You have to think, it's something written on the lines of critique of pure reason, where Kant demolishes empiricism, utilitarianism, and all other pre-Kantian systems of thought. In fact, this was done much more elaborately and much more comprehensively by Shankaracharya, 150 years later. But Gaudapada began this process. So, I explained the philosophical positions of the two schools of realists, Sautrandigas and Vaibhashikas. We have to remember, again I'm repeating, these four schools of thought emerged almost 400 years, four centuries after the passing away of Buddha. Lord Buddha had practically nothing to do with any of these philosophical systems of thoughts. He never anticipated, nor his teachings ever anticipated any of these philosophical movements which emerged 400 years after his passing away. So among the two realists, the Sautrandigas and Vaibhashikas, who are related to the Buddhist religious movement, which is known as Hinayana Buddhism, which is prevalent in Sri Lanka, Thailand, Burma, and other places. Now, there are some internal differences between these two schools of realists. Both of them accepted the reality of external objects. The Sautrandigas argue that you can never actually perceive external objects because everything is momentary. It's called kshanabhangavada, technically it is called, means the theory of the doctrine of momentariness. Everything in this world is momentary. So, if you are, see, this is a table. You may say, this is a table. Now, the table that you cognized is not the same table which you are pointing out when you make the statement, this is the table, because that table has vanished. Because everything exists only for a moment. This is called the doctrine of momentariness, which is crucial to the entire Buddhist tradition. So you can only infer. So direct perception is almost impossible of any external objects. The moment you cognize, you don't really realize that what you cognize is not the same thing which you saw with your eyes. So you can only have inferential knowledge. This is the position of Sautrantikas. then in contrast to this, the other school of realists holds the view that you can directly pursue external objects. Direct perception is possible. The argument is, inferential knowledge is not possible without direct perception. You can never infer in a void. Something should be there. You should have perceived something. Based on that, you infer. So, how do you distinguish what is perceived from what is inferred? They should be the same. So, Vaibhashikas argue, Mahavibhasha, a famous book, it's a commentary on the Tripitakas, one of the Tripitakas, based on this school of thought came into existence. The philosophical position of the Hinayana Buddhists. So they believe that external things can be directly perceived. So in Sanskrit, they're called Bahya Anumeya Vadaha and Bahya Pratyaksha Vadaha. These are not very important, but we have to remember, because these are the terms that you come across if any of you happen to make further study of these books. Now, they argue among themselves. So Gaudapada takes up the arguments of one school of realists to demolish the other school of realists. So you refute each other, you cancel each other, you reject each other, therefore your position there is no reason to believe that your position could be right, because you refute each other. Your position, one school is refuted by other school. Shankaracharya takes up these arguments later in his commentaries, of course. Now, similarly, there are strong arguments, differences of views, between the two idealists as well, between the nihilists of Nagarjuna and the subjective idealists, that is Vijnanavada. Vijnanavadin subjective idealists will argue external things are unreal. Only chittam or mind is real as a subject. That's one school of Vijnanavadins. Later, in the later school, known as the school of Dingnaga, they refuted that also. They said subject is unreal, object also is unreal. Okay, that's a different matter. So this view was refuted by Shunyavadins, the other school of idealists. They have their own arguments. Now, Gaudapada takes up their arguments and he employs the techniques and arguments of one school of thought to refute the arguments of the other school of thought. His fundamental aim is to establish that behind all this plurality, whether you accept external things or you don't accept external things, behind all these, there is one supreme self-conscious reality, which is the immanent, the transcendental, and the all-pervading, omnipresent reality. To establish this, he brings out the flaws and the defects of all other schools of thought exclusively based on reason. There is no quotation. He quotes, but he knows very well that Buddhists don't accept any of these quotations from Vedas or Upanishads as authority, because they do not accept the authority of the Vedas or Upanishads. That's why they're called atheistic schools or heterodox schools. Now, in this, from fifth verse onwards, we have been dealing with that subject. Gaudapada tries to establish this fundamental doctrine. The doctrine is this: just as the objects of dream are unreal, the objects of waking experience are also unreal. If the objects of waking experience are unreal, then of course the world cannot be real. Now, to refute Gaudapada's argument, some other schools of thought come forward with some counter arguments. They hold a common sense view. See, any ordinary person, if you ask him or her, will tell you that what we experience in dream is state, a dream state that unreal, and whatever we experience in waking states is real. There are many reasons for that. This is a general argument. Now, if Gaudapada could establish that waking state experiences are the same as dream state experiences with regard to unreality and with regard to the absence of continuity, then he can establish that this world with all the manifold phenomena cannot be real. Then what is the world? The world is actually non-existent. The world has no existence. In the sense, the world cannot be absolutely real. We should always remember, when Gaudapada says that the world is unreal, you have to remember, he means that the world doesn't exist for all time without any change. Anything which is subject to change cannot be real in the absolute sense of the term. One point should be always remembered, otherwise we will misunderstand the whole argument. Gaudapada accepts the unreality. He argues that the external world is unreal only from the highest paramarthika point of view, from the highest absolute point of view. Because from the highest absolute point of view, only that is unreal, which has no origin, because it always exists, so it cannot originate. And therefore, it can never vanish, because it always exists. So something which existed before it originated, maybe the language may be a bit adequate, something which always exists, which cannot come into existence. Coming into existence is nothing but the appearance of something within the purview of mind and the five senses of perception according to Vedanta. Everything in this world belongs to that category. Therefore, it is unreal. And the world, waking state experience, all these are unreal. Now, this is the point of view of a Vedantin from the conclusion, from the standpoint of the last word, the final word, the conclusion. From a relative point of view, from an empirical point of view, Gaudapada accepts the difference between the empirical and the purely imaginary. That is, the waking state and the dream state. Dream states are unreal, we realize it during the waking state. So, from the relative point of view, the world may be real, but the reality of the relative point of view cannot be real in the absolute sense. But he will also later prove that the relativity of the relative can be properly realized, understood, only when we realize the absolute. So long as we are within the realm of relative, we think the relative is absolute. The relativity of the relative is realized only when we transcend the relative. That's why only in the highest samadhi level, when we are in a state of experience of the identity between individual soul and cosmic soul, jivatma, paramatma identity, highest samadhi level, only at this level we experience the unreality of the relative. Because at that stage we experience the reality of the absolute. World doesn't exist in a state of samadhi. So you find in Sri Ramakrishna's gospel, you can see that. When Sri Ramakrishna comes down from the highest samadhi level, he sometimes ask his disciples to bring in a glass of water or bring some rasagula or something. Something he has to eat, because the body consciousness, the feeling of hunger, the feeling of thirst, all these are related to the waking state experience, the relative. So he wants to bring himself to the relative point of view. Because instruction, teaching, all these take spiritual sadhana, spiritual practices, meditation, reading of sacred scriptures, all these can be possible only at the relative level. In other words, at the level of ignorance. When we are in perfect identity with the Supreme Consciousness, we cannot have any kind of meditation. You know? At that time, there is neither bondage nor liberation. So, you find in the 32nd verse, you find, na nirodho na chorpatti, na bandho na cha sadhakaha, na mumukshur na vai muktaha ittesha paramarthata. At the highest level of mystical experience, there is no bondage because you are always in a liberated state. So the very idea of bondage doesn't exist. And there is no liberation. Liberation can be understood only in relation to bondage. And there is no spiritual aspirant. Spiritual aspirations, spiritual practices are possible only when you feel that you are not already a liberated soul. So, at that stage, there is neither creation, nor dissolution, nor existence, neither liberation, nor bondage. You are in a state of the highest experience, the state of experience of the identity of the individual soul and the universal soul. But then, this is not a philosophical doctrine, it is a state of experience. As we already explained when we dealt with the 7th mantra of the Upanishads, Nanta Prakyam, Na Bahish Prakyam, Na Ubhayada Prakyam, etc. That is not a state, it is an experience. And an experience is never a state. It is something which can only be called experience. So, this point has to be kept in mind when throughout this session, when we are dealing with the second chapter of the Mandukya Karya. So, I think I already dealt with this fifth mantra. We already completed this point. You know, Shankaracharya takes enormous pains to establish the reality of external objects at the relative plane. In fact, in Brahma Sutra, na bhavaha ubalabdhehe, there is a sutra, famous sutra is there, in the second chapter of Brahma Sutra. There, actually, he is trying to argue that external things do exist, not from the highest point of view, from the relative point of view. Because for Vijnanavadins or subjective idealists, Buddhists, external things are non-existent, even in relative plane. Shankara says, no. External things do have an existence at the relative plane. Because in external world, we take classes on Mandukya Karya, we meditate, we practice spiritual sadhana, spiritual practices we perform. All these are done in the external world. We make use of external objects. So how can you say that external things do not exist at the relative plane? So Shankara takes enormous pains to refute the views of subjective idealists who argue that external things are absolutely unreal. But then he establishes that from the highest absolute point of view, external things are unreal. Waking state experiences are unreal, just as dream state experiences are unreal. A number of arguments are put forward. I will take one after another. I think we dealt with the fifth mantra. The sixth mantra, as I stated last time, we already dealt with. Adho ande chayan nasti vartamanepi tattatha vidathe sadrisha santu avidatha ivalekshita. This central thesis of Gaudapada. See, what he says is that which does not exist in the beginning, as well as in the end, is non-existent. So, anything which doesn't exist in the beginning means anything which does not exist before it begins. And anything which does not continue to exist after it has ceased to exist, which means anything which can never begin, because it always exists. And anything which always exists alone is the reality. So any object which has a beginning did not exist before it began. And any object which has an end will not exist after the end. It is unreal. It is not eternal. It is non-eternal. So, but then what happens is, the second verse, vidathai sadrisha santo, avidatha iva kalpidaha. See, vidatha means unreal or illusory. Illusions. They are really illusory, but still we take them to be real. Then Gaudapada will come to certain aspects of waking state, that is Jagra state and Supna state or dream state. There are a number of arguments put forward by some other schools of thought. They will tell you, well, in waking state we have a purpose. We can plan, we can do, and we can accomplish many things. But in dream state, it is not possible. Then Gaudapada will reply, I hinted at these points last class. Gaudapada will reply, well, in waking state, you may feel hungry and you may have a full meal. And if you go to sleep, in dream state, you are hungry again. So, the purpose of food is served only in waking state. Anybody with a full meal may go to sleep and he or she may feel hungry again. Or the other way, if you are very hungry and then you go to sleep in dream, you dream as if you have a wonderful meal, 4 square meal. Then you wake up, you feel hungry again. So, each state is real from its own point of view. The utility or usefulness of one state doesn't extend to the other state. It is contained, it is confined to that particular state alone. This is the argument that he put forward to establish the unreality of the waking state just as the unreality of dream state. Why? Unreality means the purpose of food that you have eaten doesn't serve any purpose when you go to sleep, when you feel hungry in dream, even after a square meal, after a full meal in waking state. So the purpose is confined or limited to that particular state. So therefore, the argument is this. Saprayojanada tesham supne vipradivadyade tasmat adindavatvena mithyeva khalu te smrta. That's the point. So an objector, another school of thought, may put forward this argument. Your statement that objects in the waking state are illusory, like the objects in dream state, cannot be taken as valid. Because the objects in the waking state, like food, drink, vehicles, etc. You have a vehicle with you in waking state. But in dream state, you may be looking for a taxi because you don't have a vehicle, perhaps. You are walking in the street, you are looking for a taxi. And it could be other way around. If you are thinking about calling for a taxi in the afternoon, but you go to sleep in the morning and then you find there is only a vehicle in front of your doorstep. But that vehicle won't serve any purpose if you want to go to the airport. So dream objects are confined to dream. Waking state objects are confined to waking state. So they are limited by their own respective positions. Therefore, it cannot be real. So the argument is, the ability or the capacity to serve a useful purpose, which is seen in waking state, is contradicted in dream state. As you said, you know, a man in the waking state eats, but and he drinks water, but in dream he feels hungry and thirsty and so on. Therefore, the objection raised by another school of thought, most probably, remember, these objections could come from orthodox schools of thought also, Mimamsakas also. Though normally in the second chapter, you don't find much references to theistic schools of thought like the Mimamsakas or Sankhyas, because they all accept Vedic statements as authority, mostly dealing with the Buddhist philosophers. So, the objection was this, that objects in waking state serve useful purposes and yield concrete results, like appeasing hunger, thirst, etc. On the other hand, objects in dream state do not serve any purpose. Therefore, there is no similarity between dream state and waking state. Then, that is contradicted, that this objection is contradicted on the ground that each state is self-contained. The purpose of one state doesn't extend to the other state. Therefore, from this we come to a conclusion that is stated in the 8th verse. Apuram sthani dharmohi yatha surganivasinam tanayam prekshade gattva yatha iva iha susikshita. Is a statement is made here. See, this difference, the external difference between waking state and dream state is being explained. See, the objector argues that in dream state you may perhaps imagine you have 4 legs or 8 hands or 20 heads, or you are flying in the sky, or you are traveling without plane, just you can fly, physically you are flying in the sky, such dreams are possible. Of course, in the Shankara's commentary, you know, he refers to Surganivasinam, the Gaudapada uses. In dream, you may feel, you may dream that you have gone to Surga. Surga means heaven. There Saint Peter is standing there opening the doors, etc. Or sometimes you may feel you are gone to hell on the other hand. Both these things are possible. So, the angels are dancing, all this. Of course, Shankaracharya and Gaudapada, in their version, they are giving some other examples. But in modern times, we can use these examples. So, in dream, you may feel all these things happening around you, extraordinary events which are unimaginable or which are inconceivable in waking state. Now, that is true for that state. That is the implication of the statement. Apuram sthani dharmohi, this extraordinary difference. In waking state, you need a plane to fly in the sky. In dream, you don't require a plane. This differences are due to the peculiar condition prevailing in each state. In waking state, you are using your senses of action and senses of perception and your mind. In dream state, you use only your mind. Everything is mental, a mental projection. If you are using your hands and legs, then you can't think of flying in the sky. But in dream state, you are not using your hands, senses of action, or your ears or eyes, the senses of perception. Only mind is playing its role. So everything is mental projection. But it is true for that particular state. But that experience doesn't extend itself to the waking state. So, Gaudapada says that the argument that all these things exist and they are similar doesn't hold good. This is an objective argument. They are each different. The objector says, the opponent of Advaita, the opponent of Gaudapada says, these differences do exist. But Gaudapada says, these differences are due to peculiar conditions prevailing in each state. So far as the illusory nature of these experiences is concerned, there is no distinction. I already referred to this in the last class. Whatever is perceived cannot be real. That is the speciality of Vedanta. Whatever is perceived in dream state is genuine for the dreamer. Whatever is perceived in dream state is genuine for the dreamer, but doesn't find its reflection in waking state. It doesn't continue into waking state. So, they are equally unreal. If at all there are differences, those differences are due to the peculiar conditions of both the states. So far as the illusory nature, the unreality is concerned, there is perfect similarity between waking state and dream state. This is a point to be understood. Gaudapada says there is perfect similarity between dream state and waking state so far as the unreality or the illusory nature of experiences is concerned. The objector says there is no similarity because in waking state we have only one head. We have only two eyes. But in dream state, Shankaracharya in the Bhashya, in a very classic statement, he says, you know, the experiences of the dreamer. He says, the dreamer feels that he has got Sahasrakshatvam, and it means he has got 1,000 eyes. All these experiences will come. I mean, these external differences will come. But so long as the unreality or illusory nature is concerned, both are similar. Therefore, if dream experiences are unreal, then waking state experiences are also real. In the coming verses, a few more arguments are put forward by Advaitins to drive home this central doctrine. Advaitin would tell you, now, in waking state, there are different levels of reality of experiences. See, when we open our eyes and when we see an object in front of us, we think it is real. But suppose we imagine in our mind about something which doesn't exist in front of us. Even within waking state, we know the imagined thing, what is imagined is unreal. What is directly perceived with the eyes and mind is real. So even within waking state, that is the argument which is put forward in the next lines. Even in waking state, there is the so-called real and the so-called unreal. We know very well that sometimes people, when they are not dreaming, they are not sleeping, they may be sitting with eyes open. They may think, how wonderful it would be if I were somewhere else. Such reveries, imaginations, or illusory thoughts will come to anyone. But we also know that those thoughts are unreal. Sometimes we try to imagine what we really want. But we also know within ourselves that it is not real. But when we are walking in the street in San Francisco, we know it is real. That is real because it is related to waking state, it is external, it is related to the senses of action, senses of perception, and also mind. So we think walking in San Francisco street, it is real. But how wonderful it would be if I were walking in London. But this imagination may come. But along with that, we also understand the cognition also will come that it is unreal because we are in San Francisco. So within waking state also, there are two levels of reality. That's what Gaudapada is going to drive home. What is perceived in the external world, in waking state, as a part of day-to-day experience is real. What is imagined is pure imagination. It is unreal. So in waking state also, there are two levels of reality. What is obviously real and what is obviously unreal. So also in dream also sometimes you feel, well, you are tired, you are going to sleep, you are dreaming. So there is a dream within dream. They said a film, if you are seeing a cinema or a film, there a character is going to a film theater, he is seeing a film also. So which is better? Which is more real? The film is also real. When you are sitting in the theater, you are seeing a cinema, that is also unreal. But the character in the cinema is going to theater, he also sees a film. That is also unreal. The character in the cinema knows that what he sees in the screen is real. Sorry, unreal. Just as you know very well that what you are seeing in front of you is unreal. Similarly, Gaudapada says, in dream also you can dream. In dream also, there is the so-called real. Their dream proper. And then the quotation within quotation, you know, the dream within dream is unreal, even for the dreamer. So what is unreal? What is real here? Gaudapada says, everything is unreal. The dream is unreal, the dream within dream is unreal. The waking state is unreal, and the imagination taking place in waking state are both unreal. From what point of view? From the absolute point of view. From the absolute point of view, Gaudapada doesn't recognize the difference in degree of relativity or difference in degree of illusoriness. As I said last time, you know, if you are going for an examination and if you are to get 100% mark, and if you have got 100% mark, and there may be some candidates, one person has got 30%, another person 31%, another person 29%. Among them, they may quarrel. No, I have got 31%, you got only 29%. But all the three have failed in the examination. From the standpoint of a first rank holder, these 29%, the man who has got 29%, 30%, 31%, all have failed. Similarly, Gaudapada says, the minute distinction with regard to the degree of illusoriness of illusory objects doesn't count. From the highest standpoint, that is, everything is, all these are unreal or illusory. Because there is only one reality, which is Atman, the immanent, the omnipresent, the omniscient, transcendental reality. That is the only reality which exists once for all. It doesn't change. It doesn't come into existence because it always exists. And therefore, it never ceases to exist. It will never cease to exist. Everything else in this world, whether in waking state or dream state, comes into existence and disappears later. Maybe the earth may exist for a few billions of years. Your dream experience may exist for a few split seconds. both are equally unreal because they have a beginning, which means they did not exist before they began, and therefore they will have an end, which means they will not exist after the end. And there is only one reality, which is eternal. Everything else is non-eternal. So the one point to remember is, Gaudapada doesn't take into account the different degrees of, the difference in degrees of relativity or illusoriness. What is unreal from the highest point of view. But you have to remember, from the relative point of view, from the empirical point of view, there is a difference between waking state experience and dream state experience. That's why, as I said last time, Advaita or non-dualistic philosophy is not pure idealism. If you remove from it the element of realism, it could be something like either subjective idealism or the unknowability of things in themselves of Kantian idealism. Advaita is different from all this. Advaita is a combination of the highest degree of idealism with the highest degree of realism. That's why Shankaracharya, in a very famous statement, he makes an immortal statement. The very famous statement that he makes is, Prag Brahmatma Vijnana Sarva Loka Vivakaranam Satyuttu Upapattihi Yatha Supna Drishtasseva Prag Prabodhat. It comes in the Mandukya Kairika Bhashya. In Brahma Sutra Bhashya, he makes similar statements again and again. He says, just as dream experiences are real for the dreamer, so also, every person living in this world should perform action, their duties without desire, should try to attain mental purity, and should perform spiritual practices, and try to reach the highest degree of perfection. So, sarva loka vivakaranam satyuttu upapatti. This point means, the idea is this, all empirical duties should be looked upon as if they are real. You may read Mandukya Karya, you may read Upanishad, you may read the greatest Advaitic texts, but keep that in mind. Because it is not an ideology. It is a state which we should try to attain. So one should read the Upanishads, one should read Mandukya Karya, one should read all these highest Advaitic texts. And at the same time, we should also recognize that to reach this level of experience, we had to travel. And for that, we had to perform spiritual practices. We had to attain these four important qualifications. It's called sadhana chadushtaya sampatti. One is perfect, a discerning mind, which distinguishes the real from the unreal. And then complete dispassion for worldly pursuits and also for heavenly pursuits. And then perfect control of the internal and external organs. Mind, all should be under control. And then a strong desire for liberation. So it is called Nitya Nitya Vastu Vekaha Ihamutra Phalabhoga Viragaha Samadhi Sarkasambhiti Mumukshutu. Four important qualifications. So that is a very important point. So whenever we read texts like Mandukya Karya, we have to remember Mandukya Karya presents the last word, the conclusion of Advaita. And for those who have not reached that level at the experience level, should practice action without desire, dispassion, mental control of the senses, and other qualifications. And at the same time, should read these books. So, on the one hand, we will have a remote goal in mind. On the other hand, we can follow the track, the route which takes us to that destination. So that is the we have already dealt with this eighth verse, ninth verse also. That was what I was dealing with. Sopnavurtau api tvandas chedasa kalpidam tu asad behis chedo grihidam sad drishtam vaidathimeta yoho. So this is a point. So this again is an attempt on the part of Advaitin to refute the contention of the objector that the objects perceived in waking state are not similar to objects perceived in dream state. Because in dream state we experience extraordinary things, but in waking state we experience certain ordinary things. The answer is this: the extraordinary nature of dream objects are due to the peculiar condition of dream. In dream, well, it is only mental projection. So you can jump and travel to the moon. You don't need a spaceship in dream. But in waking state, you need so many scientific equipments. Waking state is like that. Its position is like that. Because there you have the senses, five senses of perception, senses of action, mind, and so on. You have to travel physical distances. In dream state, you can do all this at a mental level. That's the main difference. So that's the perfect answer is given. And then, now, in the 11th verse, a very important topic is introduced. Ubhayorabhi vaidathyam bhedanam sthanayor yadi ka edan buddhyade bhedan ko vaitesham vikalpaka. Now, a question arises. If things in both the states, I mean waking state and dream state, are equally illusory, unreal, then who is the cognizer? Who cognizes the illusory nature of all these things? Who is the cognizer, the perceiver, the subject also is illusory. So the question arises, then what is real? And who imagines these differences, these objects? That will take us to the fundamental metaphysical position in Advaita. The idea is this. It is given in the 11th, in the 12th verse. Kalpayati atmanatmanam atma devasumayaya sa eva buddhide bhedan iti vedanta nischeha. The answer is this. What is the question? The question is this, in the 11th verse. If dream experiences and waking state experiences are equally illusory and unreal, then who is seeing, who is imagining, who is perceiving all this? There should be a subject. There should be a cognizer. There should be a perceiver. That's a question. See, if somebody tells you this world is unreal, this table is unreal, we are all unreal, then who recognizes the unreality of our own existence? This question may arise. Because if you cannot answer this question, then Vedanta will become what is called anatmavada or nihilism, a kind of metaphysical anarchy. But Gaudapada gives a very wonderful answer. He says, this Atman, the immanent reality, the ever-effulgent, self-effulgent, immanent, omnipresent, transcendental reality, through its own maya, his own maya or her own maya, imagines in himself, by himself, all these external entities and internal entities, all these experiences, objects seen in dream and waking states. And apart from that immanent reality, there is no other object, which means the subject and object are the same. Subject, there is no object other than the subject. When you look upon this immanent transcendental reality through the prism of time, space and causation, you perceive this world. That's what Swami Vivekananda said. Maya is nothing but a combination of time, space and causation. That is relativity. When you look upon this transcendental reality through the prism of time, space and causation, then you think things are existing in space, in time, and they are caused by something. They are effects of something else. They are either causes or effects. And again, when you look upon this very pluralistic world without using this prism of time, space and causation, then it is Brahman or Atman. So if you try to perceive Atman through the medium of time, space and causation, you can see only this world. But a liberated soul, one who has realized the supreme reality, can live in this world, can look at this world, and still experience only the presence of Atman and Brahman. Because even when they are living in this world, when they are looking at the world, they are perceiving only Atman. They are seeing something which is beyond time, space and causation. So the idea is this. Deva, the word Deva is used. Deva is a, you find in English translation, God, G-O-D, small letter, plurally fine. But actually it means, there is a special meaning for Deva. It was the great commentator of Veda. It's in a famous book on Vedic etymology called Niruktam. It means Vedic etymology, written around 800 BC by a great writer called Yaska. It's called Niruktam. The book is called Niruktam. The first etymological work in the history of human language system. There he defines the word Deva, Dyo Dhanadva, Dyo Dhanadva, Dyusthanova, Bhavatidi. That is the definition. Deva Kasma, Deva Dhanadva, Dyotanadva, Dyusthanova, Bhavatidi. Who is Deva? What is the meaning of Deva? Then he gives three descriptions. One is this, that supreme reality who gives us wisdom and knowledge when we pray. Then Deepana means the supreme reality which is self-effulgent, which illumines our hearts and intellect. And the supreme reality who is the illuminator of the entire cosmos. These are the three meanings Vyasa gives to the word Deva. Now, in this 12th Kariga, Gaudapada calls this Atman with the word Deva, means self-effulgent. The one which is self-effulgent and also illumines the entire creation. That's a characteristic. It is self-effulgent by itself, but it lends light, illumination to the entire creation. That's the real meaning of the word Deva. So, Kalpayidi Atmanatmanam Atma Deva Sumaya. Atma is this Deva, means self-luminous Atman. Through his Maya, imagines in himself, in itself, by himself. You may use by imagine in itself, by itself, all these manifold pluralistic phenomena that you see and experience in everyday life. And that Atman is the only cognizer, the only perceiver, the only subject of those things which he himself created by his own imagination. Remember, he or she can be used. The Atman has no gender. It is supreme, the immanent, transcendental, omnipresent principle. It's called Atman. Now, this is the doctrine of Vedanta. That is the meaning of the 12th verse. Now, that reality which is one without a second, you know, you should not use the word one only. That sometimes, you know, Advaita is called monism, which is technically wrong. Advaita is not monism. Because when you talk about monism, you are talking about unity of manifoldness, manifold entities. Now, unity of manifold entities is not what exactly is implied by the word Advaita. It means ekameva Advaita, means one without a second. So Advaita should be interested in one without a second. If you're talking about unity, then you are admitting the possibility of manifoldness, plurality. If you're talking about one, you are implying the possibility of a second. First, you mean second, another one. So, Shankara uses the word ekameva advitiya, means one without a second. So, this reality, which is self-luminous deva, and which illumines entire creation, because it is the presence of this Atman as the immanent principle in everything in this world, which makes it possible to exist. So, it is self-luminous and also illuminator of the entire creation. By its own will, it creates the world. Now, if you are accepting the reality of creation, you have to say it creates the world by its own will. But actually, the world is not real. So, it is because of our ignorance of the true nature of Atman that we think the world really exists as an entity. We understand the relativity of this world when we realize the absoluteness of the absolute. If you are not aware of the absoluteness of the absolute, we often mistake the relative to be the absolute. That's why they said the relativity of the relative can be properly realized only when we realize the absoluteness of the absolute. Once we realize it, we will realize that it is this Atman, the immanent, omnipresent and transcendental principle, which is self-luminous and also illuminative of everything in this world, which is responsible for this appearance of manifoldness. That is the conclusion. I think we have already reached the end of the time. So we'll deal with the next verse in the next class. Maybe if there is time, with 5-10 minutes, if anybody wants to ask any question, we'll discuss the subject. Otherwise, conclude. Anyone who wants to any question. Excuse me, once more.
Why does this not mean nihilism?
Nihilism. Oh, yes.
Because if I am a projection and I am illuminated and by a projection
and
it is the projector that understands, then
does
it matter?
Yes. Yes, now, the answer in Advaita with philosophy is this. Of course, Gaudapada deals with it. The Shankara Bhashya deals with it. See, without what is called adhara or foundation, there cannot be an imagination. I shall give an example. Without a piece of rope lying there, you cannot mistake that rope to be the snake. Without a reality in this world, we cannot mistake that reality to be unreal. Without a ground, without a foundation, we cannot imagine anything relative. If we perceive everything to be relative, who are we? Who is the perceiver? Even the perceiver is also is unreal, then your perception that everything is unreal also wrong. If the perceiver is also unreal, then the perceiver's perception that the world is illusory is wrong, which will make the world real. So the idea is this, without a foundation, what is called science called Athara, means, see, without a foundation, you cannot superimpose upon it something else. Coming to the rope snake analogy, there should be something lying in front of you in the dim lit room. Otherwise, you won't mistake it to be a rope or piece of or a stick or a, what do you call a puchidra, means a crack on the floor, or a stick, or something else. There should be a rope. So that's why Advaitins argue the world is nothing but our reading of the absolute reality through the medium of time, space and causation, or name and form. If you look at this whole thing through the medium of time, space and causation, then you can see all this manifoldness. But if you are looking at it through time, space and causation, there should be something which you are looking at through time, space and causation. What is that? That is Atman. So there should be always a ground, a foundation. Without that, you cannot imagine anything. You cannot imagine anything in a void. See, if there is nothing on the floor, and you say if there is a snake, then it is an optical illusion. See, when the room is not properly lit, and there is something lying on the floor, and it looks like a snake, then you bring light, and you understand it is a rope. There should be a rope. If there is no rope, if there is nothing, then you cannot mistake anything for a snake. So what is that which you mistake? The ground of everything. That ground is Atman. In fact, that is where Advaita takes a different turn from Shunyavada. See, Nagarjuna goes, he says it's called Nagarjuna's destructive dialectic discourse. He goes on denying everything. But Nagarjuna in Madhyamika Karika uses terms like Nastyastidi Varjidaha, such terms he uses. Nagarjuna says the reality is voidness, emptiness. And he also uses it is ekam, advaitam, and it is neither existence nor non-existence. Such terms Nagarjuna uses. In fact, many of the terms which Advaitins use were used by Nagarjuna. But then he says it is shunyam, it is emptiness. So, and then once you realize that emptiness, you get bliss, you get the bliss of nirvana. So who is the subject who is enjoying the bliss of nirvana when you realize your identity with that voidness, shunyata? So there should be a subject. Even to understand the unreality of the unreal, there should be a subject who cannot be unreal, who should be real. It's the idea. That reality is Atman. So it cannot be anatmavada, or this called cannot be Buddhist niratmavada or anatmavada or nihilism. Is it called nihilism in English? Nagarjuna comes very close to Advaita, then he takes a left about turn, means the opposite direction he moves. So it becomes an intellectual, metaphysical anarchy. But Advaitin says, it's true, but there is an all-pervading, immanent, transcendental reality, which is one without a second. In fact, when we realize that reality, we are not getting a new knowledge. We are removing the wrong notion that we normally entertain with regard to what we are. When we realize Brahman, we are not realizing Brahman. We are only removing the wrong notion that we entertained. That we normally, that we, I am this body, I am this mind, I am the intellect, I am so on. All these wrong notions are removed. And then you realize that. So it is not a new, it's kind of spiritual homecoming. We rediscover our true nature. That is the meaning of Advaitic realization, is called, I think. So. Any other? I shall come to you again. Before that, there was another student. Please, what is it? Misperception of Atman. Oh, yes, in fact, there is a school of thought, Veda, Veda, means that in Vedantic tradition also, not Advaitic tradition, there is a non-Advaitic tradition which accepts both the multiplicity and also unity. Now, the plurality is explained in terms of different media through which the reality manifests. When you think of the media, we can admit the existence of plurality. But through all days, there is one reality which is manifesting, the immanent reality, the transcendental, omnipresent reality. So when you think of that spirit, that supreme consciousness, which is manifesting through all these media, then you have to admit the reality is one without a second. It could manifest through so many media. Electricity could become light energy, heat energy, and so on. So that consciousness, supreme consciousness, could manifest through innumerable media. See, Vivekananda once made a statement, Swami Vivekananda made a statement, the difference between an amoeba and a Buddha is one of degrees, not of kind. See, so Swami Vivekananda was telling, see, the same supreme consciousness manifests in an amoeba, which is a very primitive creature. And a Buddha means the illumined, the liberator illumined, archetypal man of wisdom, enlightenment. Now, what's the difference? In Buddha, the manifestation of this consciousness has reached its perfection. In amoeba, it is in a very, very low degree. So, all the creatures, right from amoeba up to Buddha, all these are different media through which this supreme consciousness, Atman, manifests. But the reality is one, the media through which it manifests could be manifold. That's the idea. That is the Advaitic view. In dualistic Madhva philosophy, they do not accept the oneness of the media. That's called, I won't go to those details, you know. They believe that God is different from world. World is different from different beings. And different, all these beings are different from God. And there are diversities between different objects in the world. And there are diversities between different beings in this world. Living beings in the world. So, if you accept plurality at the ontological level, then you have to accept Dvaita. their ontology is entirely different from the ontological ideas of Advaita philosophy. Thank you. So, no, you can ask it. It's not 10 minutes. It may not take more than 5 minutes. Why don't you? You mean there is no similarity between...
I mean, between my dream experience and someone else's.
Oh, yeah. Yes. And in dream, what is happening, the mind is projecting the accumulated tendencies and impressions. And those projections are seen or experienced as dream objects. And... mind, not really mind, it's chittam. Chittam, which is a reservoir. It is the depository of all tendencies and impressions that we gather. The subtle residue of actions, mental, verbal, all actions, of course. So, in dream, they are projected forward. And for every individual, each individual has his own or her own experiences in waking state. And these waking state experiences have some relationship with the dream experiences. The difference is, one is gross, other is subtle. Otherwise, there is always a subtle relationship between waking state experiences and dream state experiences. In waking state, we perform many duties, and these duties leave different types of impressions and tendencies in the chittam residue, depending upon our own nature, depending upon external circumstances, and so on. And we go to sleep. So, depending upon these tendencies and impressions, and also the attitude with which we have accumulated them in our chittam, the chittam projects this. I mean, chitta means mind. Here we are used with mind. Chitta means nothing but that part of mind which collects all tendencies and impressions and keeps as if in a bag. Now, in dream, they're projecting in the form of dream objects. They have to be different. There cannot be any universality or any identity or similarity among different people. Because each jiva, each jiva has its own subtle body, linga sharira, subtle body. Its own mind, buddhi, five senses, and five panchapranas, and five senses of perception, five senses of action, and panchapranas. So 17 elements. So this linga sharira, or the subtle body, it retains all these vrittis and vasanas, tendencies and impressions. And that's our external personality. That's a personality. So according to the nature of the personality, we collect different types of tendencies and impressions. And we perform different duties accordingly. And accordingly, they are projected to the surface in dream. So it happens. It can be deep, they can be identity. The point is, the experiencer minus these experiences is the same. See, it is called Taijasa. In dream state, that individual seer is called Taijasa. What is Taijasa? Taijasa is nothing but that Atman, that Turiya, playing the role of a subject of dream objects. That is called Taijasa. The seer, the drashta, the subject which is experiencing all these dream objects. But you remove that role of a subject or seership, then it's Atman only, Turiya only. So, as Turiya, as pure Drishta, it is the same. But as Taijasa, it will be different. Taijasa means the Drashta, the Turiya playing the role of experiencer of dream objects. Because experiences are different, dream objects are different, but the seer, the pure Drashta, is the same. In association with the experiences, there is difference. When dissociated, when the association is gone, it is pure Drashta. Turiya is the same. There is no difference. Yes, that is true. That is only from the relative point of view. Yeah, I said, you know, I made this statement many times. See, from a relative point of view, there is a difference between dream state and waking state. Relative point of view means from an empirical point of view, from a common sense point of view. There is a difference between dream state and waking state. The differences are called, you know, kala bheda, Sukshma, Sthula Bheda, and Kala Bheda, Sukshma, and then Desha Bheda. Means there is difference with regard to time. See, in dream we require only split second to travel thousands of miles. In waking state we need several hours. So there is time difference. Space difference is there. One may go to sleep in San Francisco, he may dream that he has reached London. So, space difference. And then, there is the difference with regard to subtlety or grossness. Waking state experiences are gross in nature, and dream experiences are subtle in nature. So, these differences are admitted by Gaudapada doesn't make that difference, but Shankaracharya, his Bhashya, he built up the whole edifice of Advaita. Mandukya philosophy, he explains all these differences. So, there are differences, no doubt. That is admitted in Vedanta. From an empirical point of view, common sense point of view, there is difference between dream state and waking state. But from the highest point of view, there is no difference. That is it. Okay. Om Shanti Shanti Shanti.